Good morning, everybody. Dear current members of ABC, dear past members of ABC, dear prehistoric members of ABC, dear friends of ABC, dear everybody else, and dear Gerd. In the name of my colleagues Ute Fevert and Ulmer Lindenberger, I would like to welcome you to this day of festivities. There are two occasions that we want to mark today. Gerd's retirement, and by extension, ABC's retirement. But let me take the bull by the horn right away. In retirement? Really? The notion of retirement is, of course, an administrative concept and has little to do with the life of Gerd or of ABC. A few weeks ago, I was at the Spudem conference in Haifa, and many people asked me about Gerd and his future. One representative exchange was with Peter Aiton, who wanted to know what retirement means. I told him that in Gerd's case, it means that he needs no longer to take part in the infamous LKs, the monthly meetings of the directors, and the Max Planck Society no longer has demands on his time. Moreover, he will continue to lead the Harding Center. Peter's spontaneous response was this: "Oh, I get it. Retirement in Gerd's case just means that we simply get to read twice as many articles and books by him than we do now." Cool! So Gerd, the community's expectations concerning your retirement are anything but modest. I think the same can be said about the supposed retirement of ABC. ABC does, of course, not end today. ABC lives on. It lives on in us and through us. It lives on in Bloomington, Syracuse, Oklahoma, Southampton, Constance, Ludwigsburg, Lausanne, Basel, Geneva, Grenada, Tilburg, Beijing, and in many, many other places in the world, including at this very institute at the Center for Adaptive Rationality. ABC has been a research center, but it has also been an ever-growing body of ideas, and these ideas will continue to flourish. So yes, indeed, we do celebrate a pivotal point in Gerd's life and in ABC's history, but certainly not a retirement in the classic sense. Rather, we are celebrating the transition into a new era for Gerd and the world of ideas ABC represents. Let me for a moment don the hat of the Institute and speak as one of Gerd's colleagues, and in doing so, stand in for Ulmer Lindenberger, the current managing director, who will join us later today. Gerd has been a director at this institute since 1997, that is for 20 years. From 1995 to 1997, he was a director in his beloved hometown, Munich. Directors shape the institute in which they work. Gerd was part of an important generation of directors in this one. His colleagues in 1997 and for many years were the late Paul Baltes, Jürgen Baumert, and Karl Ulrich Meyer. This was a generation of directors whose task it was to redefine and to extend the scientific mission of this institute. Remember that this institute was originally founded to provide a scientific foundation for the political reforms of West Germany's schools and universities. Once these reforms were implemented, this institute lost part of its raison d'être. In very different ways, these four directors defined a new scientific mission. While there are many things that Gerd contributed to this mission, let me highlight just three for them now. The first one was perhaps best put by Herbert Simon when he described the contribution of simple heuristics that make us smart. In his quote on the book jacket, I just looked it up again, he wrote the following: "In the past few years, the theory of rational human behavior has broken loose from the empirically unsupported notion that deciding rationally means maximizing expected utility. Research has learned to take seriously and study empirically how real human beings actually address the vast complexities of the world they inhabit. Simple heuristics offers a fascinating introduction to the revolution in cognitive science, striking a great blow for sanity in the approach to human rationality." What I would add to this portrayal is that Gerd's work on bounded rationality did not begin with simple heuristics, but dates back to the work on cognitive illusions, their alleged reality, the assumed narrow norms, and their vague explanations. I think without this work, the latter work on precise computational models of heuristics would have not been possible. And by drawing an important distinction between single event probabilities and frequencies, for instance, natural frequencies, and demonstrating frequencies to be the single most powerful measure to devise statistical reasoning, Gerd struck another great blow for sanity against the backdrop of a science of decision making that was in danger of becoming a science of irrationality. A second theme that Gerd, together with other directors such as Wolfgang Edelstein, contributed to the Institute was the fact that there is more to the German concept of Bildung than education in schools. By demonstrating how important the ability to reason statistically is for navigating a world full of risks and uncertainty, he extended Bildung beyond institutional education. In his understanding of Bildung, those competences are particularly important that empower people, in Kant's phrase, to emerge from the self-imposed knowledge. Because Gerd loves these words of Kant's so much, let me quote Kant in German. Aufklärung ist der Ausgang des Menschen aus seiner selbstverschuldeten Unmündigkeit. Unmündigkeit ist das Unvermögen, sich seines Verstandes ohne Leitung eines anderen zu bedienen. Indeed, to help people to make the most of their minds has been Gerd's objective for many years. Still a third dimension that Gerd has brought to the Institute is the determination to step outside of the ivory tower and get engaged in often heated discussions about public policies targeted to improve healthcare, medical education, banking regulation, public risk communication, and so on. He was already involved in these endeavors long before behavioral science evidence became fashionable in public policy circles. And it is both fascinating and a slightly bit disheartening to see that in light of the current triumphant advance of nudging, another campaign for sanity is needed all over again. Gerd, this is indeed not a time to leave the pitch. Now, I'm sure that you will hear more, much more about Gerd and ABC's ideas and accomplishments throughout the day. Therefore, let me talk a bit more about an ancient time. Only four people can speak about with some authority. Gerd, Uli, known to most of you as Ulrich, Peter Sedlmayr, who is sitting here, and myself. 1995 in Munich marks the beginning of the Big Bang for ABC. But there was also something that came before the Big Bang. Because so few people can tell you about this time, I thought I should relate to you some memories that are interesting in light of what would follow later. I call these memories the bloody behaviorist, the Austrian Saunagipfel, and a serendipitous discovery. So let me share these memories with you. Let's begin with the bloody behaviorist. This goes back to my first class that I took with Gerd. I was in the third semester, and it was a seminar, and we read some of psychology's classics, including Walden II, Skinner's Behaviorist Utopia of How to Use Instrumental Learning Theory to Build a Better World. A discussion ensued between Gerd and a student, who clearly was bothered by reducing people to stimulus response organisms. Gerd, of course, you know Gerd, of course, played the die-hard behaviorist, refuting all her arguments. Eventually, she said, totally exhausted, Herr Gigerenzer, Sie sind ein verdammter Behaviorist. Herr Gigerenzer, you are a bloody behaviorist. Gerd responded, if my colleagues heard you calling me a behaviorist, they die laughing. Why do I tell you this story? Well, over the years, I've heard Gerd being called many things, a historian, a statistician, a philosopher, and worst of all, an economist. I think these multiple identities speak volumes in one respect, namely Gerd loves ideas and theories no matter where they come from, and these identities testify to his ability to switch with great ease between different conceptual lenses. I'm sure we all learn from this ability, perhaps Gerd's most remarkable talent. The Austrian Saunagipfel, the second memory I have. I have many others, but those are the ones that I share with you. ABC is legendary for its daily tea time at 4 p.m. It is crucial for the group's social cohesion, and it offers the platform for people from different disciplines to meet at least once a day. I've heard Gerd proudly talk about this ritual many times. I agree, tea time has been an important social clue for ABC. But was it really Gerd's invention? This may sound immodest, but Peter Siegenmeier and I believe it was ours. It all started in Salzburg and was driven by our shared love for Austrian coffee, the Melange, and the heavenly Zaunergipfel. Every day, 4 p.m. on the dot, Peter and I would start our descent to the cafeteria in the university and feast. Uli, you know Uli, not a coffee drinker and also, of course, having a huge stash of other foods in his office, would rarely join us. Once Peter and I moved from Salzburg to Chicago, we continued this 4 p.m. ritual, now together with Gerd, who in Salzburg was often away. In Chicago, the three of us, we were the peculiar Germans who were idle enough taking time out every afternoon to have coffee and cake. It is my belief that if Peter and I contributed nothing else to ABC, then at least, we inspired ABC's best known social institution. A serendipitous discovery, that's the third memory. Many of ABC's classic computer simulation experiments were conducted with the German city size environment. There were times when people at conferences expressed suspicion about the odd sample of German cities, all those with more than 100,000 inhabitants. Something struck them as really wrong with this sample, given that Take the Best does so well in it. This environment must have been very, very, very carefully selected. Nothing, however, could be further from the truth. Back in Salzburg, Gerd wrote an email to Uli and me and asked us to come up with a data set of objects and cues. The data set should permit a very talented graduate student whom we just met, by the name of Daniel Goldstein, to run some simulations. Now remember, those were days, the pre-Google days, and we hardly knew where to start. This all changed when one of us had the idea of perusing a pocket calendar. For those of you who are under 30, this was a little physical book in which one would write down one's daily meetings and other obligations. Gerd still has one. Remember the famous blue little book? These little books typically had all kinds of useful and totally useless information. And there it was. The perfect reference class for two alternative choice tasks. All German cities with more than 100,000 residents, including cues such as university city, airport, license plate, and so on. Elated, we sent the list off to Gerd, and the rest is history. I share these three memories because they offer some key to Gerd's and ABC's success over the years. A love of ideas, nourishing social rituals, and last but not least, a little bit of luck. Dear ABC, I wish all of you that you can hold on to these things wherever you go, whatever you will do. Dear Gerd, I'm sure I speak for everybody here. We wish you many more healthy years, more victories in the struggle for sanity, and a lot of fun along the way. Thank you.